Welcome to today's webinar on how to achieve the world's best MEPS. My name is Matt Malinowski, and I'm the Director of Climate Research at CLASP, an international appliance efficiency organization, where I identify potent appliance efficiency opportunities and support policymakers worldwide with novel tools and research. I will be your host for today's event, and I am joined by my colleagues from CLASP, as well as several international experts. Together, we will explore the current state of MEPS around the world and how economies can increase their ambition. Thank you so much for your time and interest, and I hope that this will be a great learning opportunity. So here's a brief agenda of today's event. I'll begin with just a brief introduction to CLASP and the report, and then present the major findings together with my colleague, Shireen Mavandad. Next, we'll turn to our panel of international experts to learn from their experiences and get some of their recommendations. And lastly, we'll turn it over to you, the audience, so that you can be sure to ask your questions of our panelists. Our questions will be through the Q&A feature or the chat. Feel free to send your questions at any point, and then we will present them to the panelists when we can, or answer them on the fly if it's a quick clarification. So we hope this will be an interactive event and looking forward to spending this time with you. So first, a little bit about CLASP. We're an organization focused on improving the energy and environmental performance of appliances we use every day, accelerating our transition to a more sustainable world. And we do this with on-grid appliances where efficiency reduces energy, pollution, CO2 emissions, contributing to climate mitigation, as well as off-grid, where more efficient appliances allow for the use of a smaller solar photovoltaic system, thereby reducing the costs or increasing the energy service that can be provided with the same solar photovoltaic system, thereby providing better energy services and improving people's quality of life. Today, I'll be speaking about our new report on the world's best MEPS. You can find it online at our tools page, clasp.ngo/tools, or feel free to scan the QR code that you see here. The report covers the MEPS levels and ambition across 6 appliances and 10 economies. So we cover lighting, refrigerators, ACs, motors, and 2 kinds of heating appliances, space and water heating, across the 10 economies that you see on this slide. We compare the economies to each other, but more importantly, we compare them against international benchmarks, such as United for Efficiency's model regulations, as well as countries' own commitments to decarbonizing and electrifying their space and water heating. And the goal, again, is to allow economies to learn from each other, as well as to continue driving ambition. We tried to conduct a fair comparison. We all understand that not all economies can reach the same MEPS levels. There's the issue of climate, as well as product availability. You may not be able to have the same product operate at the same levels in different places, or the product may not even be available. Then there's the factor of economics. A lot of the organizations that we work with are constrained to only set MEPS that are cost effective, meaning that the efficiency and the reduced fuel prices or energy price costs will outweigh the higher cost of efficiency. Well, prices for appliances are different around the world, as are the costs of energy. So the economics will vary, and so can the MEPS. Nonetheless, we believe that knowing where the next level is useful, as it can be the target of a voluntary program such as labeling or incentives. And lastly, there's the issue of products not being comparable. So here's an example with water heaters from an IAEA benchmarking report from a couple of years ago. The blue triangles represent Chinese water heaters, whereas pink and purple are ones in the US. And in China, most of the water heaters are below 100 liters, whereas in the US, they're greater than 100 liters in size. And so how do you compare the two MEPS, which will really target these distinct populations of water heaters? Well, for our analysis, we try to identify representative units that try to bridge that gap by finding a unit that's somewhere in the middle globally, evaluating the MEPS for that unit, making the comparison, even though there will be larger and smaller units and the MEPS may be higher or lower for those units in given countries. So your results can differ depending on what the unit is. However, we believe that this is nonetheless instructive to see where the MEPS are for some of these common units. So let me begin with an example from refrigerators. For refrigerators, we chose a 400 liter frost-free refrigerator freezer with a 300 liter fresh food compartment and a 100 liter top-mounted freezer. In some countries, refrigerators are smaller, in others, they're larger, but we thought that this was a good middle of the road unit that would allow us to see how the MEPS compare. And we used annual energy consumption. Of course, in addition to refrigerator size, we have this issue of climate. Again, in some places that are warmer, the refrigerators are tested at a higher temperature, around 32 degrees Celsius, whereas in others, they're tested at 24 degrees. And so to make the comparison fair, we would have to adjust the MEPS to reflect this difference in temperature, because at the lower temperature, we have lower heat load of the compartments and a higher coefficient of performance, or COP, of the compressor. So how much better or more efficient is the performance at the lower temperature? Here's an analysis from a recent IEC standards process, which found in the upper right, you can see performance at 32 degrees Celsius, while in the middle, it would be the performance at around 24 degrees Celsius. So we ended up doing these kinds of calculations to lower the MEPS to make them all comparable to each other at 24 degrees Celsius. Here's another illustration of this process. So starting with number one, the MEPS at 32 degrees, we scaled the MEPS down to 24 degrees Celsius by lowering them. However, in some cases, the adjusted volume would also change. The MEPS are often expressed in terms of adjusted volume. So then we would have to take that into account. And so finally, in step four, you can see how that resultant MEPS would look at the lower temperature for that representative unit of 400 liters. So with that out of the way, let me move on to the comparison. Here you see the economies that have the lowest MEPS for that representative unit fridge, along with the United for Efficiency model regulations for that same size. The model regs level is 279 kilowatt hours per year. So as you can see, the good news is there are many economies that are already meeting or exceeding this level, and one more that's right on the cusp there, which, you know, again, is great news. This is a level that appears to be broadly achievable with today's technology and with some of the products that are globally traded. And so our recommendation would be for all economies to aim for that U4E regulation level, which would be 279 kilowatt hours per year for our unit at 24 degrees. For those economies that already meet it, they should next try to match U4E's intermediate target of 223 kilowatt hours per year for that model, or whatever it is for their specific temperature conditions. Next, I'll talk briefly about residential water heaters. Here, some of the challenges are that there's a whole diversity of product types. There are gas and electric, there are storage versus instantaneous. So we really focused on gas storage and instantaneous and electric storage. Those are the categories where there is significant room for improvement. We didn't look at electric instantaneous or solar water heating, even though it's quite popular in many of the economies that we analyzed. Unfortunately, it's not always possible to convert to solar water heating. And so we wanted to make sure that whatever recommendations we had would be broadly applicable. And so we looked at major technology shifts. This was also the conclusion of the IEA research that I mentioned earlier, which is that, you know, there are small incremental improvements, and then there are major technology shifts such as moving gas water heating to condensing levels, which are more than 86% efficient, or electric storage to heat pumps, which, because they draw heat from the ambient air, can be appear greater than 100% efficient. So those were really where we thought a lot of the benefit would be. These larger shifts wouldn't get bogged down in some of these conversions that we talked about earlier, or the difference in product sizes. So again, we looked at economies that have regulations that require large proportions of their stock or market to use these efficiency levels. For instance, you can see here in the US, there's a regulation that all water heaters greater than 55 gallons, which is a little more than 200 liters, have electric storage water heaters of that size, have heat pumps. Electric storage heaters in that, those sizes are around 20% of the current installed stock. And so that's why the US gets a 20% on this ranking, right? Basically 20% of the water heaters are currently subject to those ambitious heat pump requirements. In contrast, in the EU, there is a very similar requirement, also heat pump efficiencies for larger water heaters. However, those water heaters make up a much smaller portion of their installed base. And that's the same case in the UK, which has the same requirement as the EU, but a smaller proportion of water heaters. In contrast, in Canada, there is a requirement for all instantaneous water heaters to have condensing efficiency, but those make up a small proportion of the stock, hence the score below that 5% target. Moving on to space heating, we again use very similar criteria. Looking at gas furnaces, electric resistance, we looked at, can countries meet condensing requirements? Are they requiring heat pumps? In addition, we looked at one-way air conditioners, which can be used just for cooling, or if they are made reversible, if they're required to be reversible, they can be used for heating and supply a large portion of a country's heating. It's also known as air-to-air heat pumps. Let me give an example from Japan. In particular, if you look at the lower two graphs, you can see in blue that the majority of the space heating shipments are actually these air-to-air heat pumps or reversible air conditioners. And they dominate gas and kerosene space heaters, which are used in the remainder of the homes. And so as a result, Japan gets the highest score, with reversible heat pumps being responsible for 78% of the heating market. China is close behind with around 40 some percent of the shipments and the stock being heat pumps, primarily in the south of the country. And again, Canada takes an alternative approach, requiring condensing heating efficiencies for many of its gas appliances, namely furnaces and boilers. And so our recommendation for space heating as well as for water heating would be for economies to require these condensing efficiencies for gas appliances and heat pumps for electric appliances and eventually all appliances. And then, of course, replacing one-way air conditioners with heat pumps. And so you can see a demonstration of this in the following roadmap from the Canadian Energy and Mines Ministers Conference, which finds that in the short term, they're going to move to 90% or condensing technology for space heating, and then longer term, greater than 100% efficiency for heat pumps. And so we hope that through this research, we show that, you know, these ambitions are already being achieved in many countries, and that these are good, ambitious targets for the remainder of the world as well. So that concludes my portion of this presentation. And I would now like to hand it over to Shireen Mavandad, who is a co-author of the World's Best MEPS report. Shireen is a research associate at CLASP, and she has supported myriad projects ranging from researching the inclusivity of off-grid appliances to modeling the projected emissions from refrigerants in cooling products. So please take it away, Shireen.
Thanks, Matt, and thanks everyone for attending. So like Matt said, I'm just gonna be going over the last three products that we covered in our report. So starting off with lighting, we looked specifically at residential indoor non-directional general surface lamps. And to standardize the product, we looked at products with luminous flux of 800 lumens and a color rendering index of 80. And the metric we used to compare MEPS across all economies was luminous efficacy and lumens per watt. And another key thing in our analysis is that we only ranked economies with technology neutral MEPS. This means that they have one policy that pertains to all types of lighting instead of separate policies for LEDs, CFLs, and incandescents. An example of the policies that we looked at and how we use our standardization, oftentimes the products were broken out by their lumens. So we look for the 800 lumen standardization that we're using and then find the corresponding nominal power that's associated with it. And to calculate luminous efficacy, we just divide the lumens, the 800 lumens, by that nominal power. And this is an example of Canada's policy. And using that method, Canada has a luminous efficacy requirement of 18 lumens per watt. With that being said, what we defined as the target for ambitious lighting MEPS was 90 lumens per watt. And the reason we chose this number is because it ensures that inefficient lighting products like CFLs and incandescent bulbs are completely phased out of the market. And it is also in line with U4E's model regulation, which suggests a MEPS requirement of at least 80 lumens per watt. And of the 10 economies that we assessed, the EU and UK are the only two to have successfully phased out CFLs and incandescent lamps through that MEPS level of 90 lumens per watt. And they do so by using technology neutral lighting policies. And just to emphasize the importance of why we are suggesting to use technology neutral policies, this is what the comparison chart would look like if we looked only at economies LED specific policies. And as you can see, both India and Indonesia come within 25% of meeting that 90 lumen per watt criteria for LED lighting. However, this is not an accurate representation of their lighting market because CFLs and incandescent lamps continue to be sold and make up a significant portion of the market and thereby result in high lighting energy consumption in both countries. So it renders not as helpful to have very ambitious MEPS for LED lighting, but not for the other two product categories because they'll still slip through the cracks into the market. With that being said, what we recommend for residential lighting is that all economies should adopt technology neutral MEPS at 90 lumens per watt or greater to phase out CFLs and incandescent lamps. And partially why we want to greatly emphasize this recommendation is because the widespread deployment of LEDs in all economies by 2025 is essential to achieve that net zero emissions goal by 2050. And additionally, economies that already meet this requirement, like the EU and UK, should strive for even more stringent MEPS of at least 120 lumens per watt, which was identified to be an ambitious target for LED products. Moving on to electric motors. For motors, we look specifically at three-phase alternating current induction motors with a voltage of less than 1,000. And the metric we used to compare MEPS across all economies was the efficiency class used under IEC 60034, as well as if additional MEPS for motor-driven applications, this would include fans, pumps, or air compressors, was included in the economy's policy. So just to exemplify that, the IE class ranges range from IE1 to IE5, and economies would receive a score based on that level. So if an economy uses the IE2 level, they would receive a score of 2, and if they use the IE3 level, they'd receive a score of 3. And as you can see from this map, many of the economies that we looked at are split between IE2 and IE3. This map also shows that the EU and UK are the only two economies that have some motors that fall under the IE4 class, and they are the first economies to set standards at that level. However, when we take a closer look at their policies, it actually splits motors in that less than 1,000 volt range that we're looking at between IE2, IE3, and IE4, depending on the specific voltage range. And motors within the 0.75 to 1,000 kilowatt range, which make up the majority of energy consumption in those countries, use the IE3 class. And therefore, in this analysis, IE3 is what we use to rank the EU and UK. So they both receive a score of 3. As I mentioned as well, economies receive additional points to their score based on if they included the addition of motor-driven applications in their policy. So if economies had MEPS for pumps, fans, air compressors, they received an additional half point to their score. This means the maximum attainable score would be a 5.5, meaning that economy uses a 5 level and then also had additional components in their policy. But what we defined as the target for ambitious MEPS is a score greater than 3. This score is equivalent to U4E's model regulation of using the IE3 efficiency standard. And our results show that Canada, China, the EU, UK, and US are all leaders in electric motor MEPS, with Brazil and Japan within the 25% of that target threshold. What sets the leaders higher than a score of 3 is that they all had those additional MEPS requirements for variable speed drives, industrial pumps, fans, or air compressors. And going into our recommendations, we recommend that all economies should align their motor MEPS with U4E's model regulation and require a minimum efficiency level of IE3, and those leading economies should strive for more ambitious MEPS of IE4 or IE5. Economy should also consider adopting requirements for additional motor components if they do not already include them. Moving on to ACs, for air conditioners, we looked at split systems with a 7 kilowatt cooling capacity, and the metric used to compare MEPS across economies was the ISO's CSPF watt hour per watt hour seasonal energy efficiency metric. And if an economy did not use a seasonal energy efficiency metric, meaning that they're still using EER, they were not ranked in our analysis, as that lack of using a seasonal energy efficiency metric identifies that that policy is outdated. So different economies have different seasonal energy efficiency metrics, and in order to convert them all to ISO CSPF watt hours per watt hours, we use the methodology outlined in the 2020 paper Lost in Translation by Juan Park. And this paper was very helpful. It had a very clear equation for how to convert from each economy's specific seasonal energy performance metric into this standardized unit. And so that's the methodology that we use to get everything into comparable numbers. These are the results that were shown in our paper. We had the target set at 6.1 watt hours per watt hours, but it was actually recently brought to our attention that we were using the wrong AC size to determine China's MEPS. We were using the 4 kilowatt size instead of our standardized 7 kilowatts. So therefore, these results are not accurate. They're going to be updated in the report and tool as soon as possible. And these are actually the correct values in accurate comparison chart. So what we define as ambitious MEPS for ACs are at or above the cooling seasonal performance factor of 5.1 watt hours per watt hours. This target is aligned with the current minimum standard in U4E's model regulation. And our analysis found that China's AC MEPS levels for cooling only products meet this level, and Japan's top runner requirement is not too far behind. And Brazil, the EU, UK, and US are all also within 25% of this target threshold. And you'll notice on this chart, there are two scores included for China. One is for cooling only units, which are predominantly exported to other economies. And the other is for reversible heat pumps, which comprise 97% of the room air conditioner market in China. And it should be also be noted that China has separate MEPS for fixed and variable speed cooling units. And this is similar to what I was talking about in the lighting section of the report, where having different policies for LEDs and CFLs can allow for less efficient technologies to slip through the cracks. So both of these things kind of call out the need for technology neutral policies, as all types of cooling units should be held to the same efficiency standard to maximize environmental benefits. With that, leading into the recommendations, we recommend that at a minimum, all economies should align their standards with U4E's guidelines and adopt technology neutral MEPS of 5.1 watt hours per watt hours or greater. And the reason we think that this is a feasible goal is because China produces 70 to 80% of the room air conditioners sold around the world. And this means that the technology and supply chain exists to make this a feasible standard. And additionally, any economy using just an energy efficiency ratio, EER, should switch to a seasonal performance metric for fixed and variable speed air conditioners as soon as possible. And that concludes the report section. I'm going to hand it back over to Matt to introduce our panelists for tonight.
Thank you so much for the presentation, Shireen. And I invite everybody for more detail to visit our website at clasp.ngo/tools to dig further into the report and the findings. Next, however, I would like to introduce our panel of international experts to react to the findings and share their experiences from their work, as well as make recommendations on actions that countries and economies should pursue to achieve world's best MEPS. So starting on the left here with Patrick Blake. Patrick works at the United Nations Environment Program, UNEP, where he focuses efforts on the United for Efficiency, or U4E initiative, which supports countries in the transition to energy efficient lighting, appliances, and equipment. Patrick oversees the development of different policymaker tools and resources. In addition, oversees different regional harmonization of MEPS and labeling, including currently in Southeast Asia, in East and Southern Africa. Welcome, Patrick. Dr. Lu Meng is a director of the Division of Energy Conservation and Low Carbon Development within China National Institute of Standards, or CNIS. His division is in charge of energy efficiency standard development for a number of appliances, including room air conditioners and electric motors. Welcome, Dr. Meng. And lastly, Somai Pun is the Director of Asia Pacific Operation of the International Institute for Energy Conservation, or IIEC. He has over 25 years of experience in promoting and implementing energy efficiency and renewable energy in 27 countries across Africa, Asia, and the Pacific. He recently supported the ASEAN Center for Energy and multiple ASEAN member states in preparation of roadmaps and implementation plans to promote high efficiency air conditioners and motors. Welcome, Somai. Thank you all for joining us and looking forward to your insights. So first, I'll just kick off the discussion with a couple questions based on your experiences. So first, what potential challenges do you foresee in advancing MEPS in the countries that you have expertise in? And what tools can policymakers use to overcome those challenges? And why don't we start with Patrick?
Thanks, Matt, for that. And thanks, CLASP, for inviting me to this webinar. Really appreciate the report and the reference to the U4E model regulations. Again, I'm from United for Efficiency, which is led by UNEP. On the potential challenges, so we work with a lot of countries, developing, emerging economies throughout Asia, Africa, and Latin America. So one of the challenges that we often see is the time that it takes to develop policies, that it takes time, and often the MEPS and other policies are developed from scratch for the country. And that, of course, takes time and resources for it to be done. So in order to help with that, we developed the model regulations, which were referenced, but just to briefly describe those a bit more, it's a template regulation. It has all the language definitions within it. And it's something that can be used by a policymaker and different stakeholders in the country as a starting point for developing policies. And as it's been used here within the report, it helps to really benchmark where countries stand as far as policies at the moment now. That's very helpful how it's been used within the reports. The model regulations have been developed for several products, including refrigerators, ACs, motors, transformers, lighting. And at the moment, we're also developing model regulations for fans and heat pumps, and also off-grid refrigeration. Soon thereafter, we're also work on commercial air conditioning as well. Again, I would encourage the participants to really look at that model regulations. They're available on our website, and consider it as something for when you're developing policies in your country. It was developed in a very consultative process with organizations on the call today, but many others from NGOs, from governments, and also from manufacturers. So it really brought together those different experiences, and the expectation is that it's a starting point and will help accelerate policy developments in countries. I'm happy to go into more details on it. Thanks, Nat.
Great. How about yourself, Samai? What are your thoughts about challenges that you've seen, and what tools can policymakers use to overcome those challenges?
Thank you, CLASP, for producing the good benchmarking report. Because this is the tool, I mean, I would like to react to the tool first. What tool can help countries advancing? The benchmarking is something that really can help a country, you know, to see where other countries are in terms of, you know, MEPS level. And the U4E regulation model is also a very good tool. And when we help ASEAN develop the regional and national roadmap, the U4E regulation model is something that really provide very good, you know, background and also the technical references for the ASEAN member state. But in terms of challenge, you can see that the technical is not a major challenge now. If you look at the products, which is assuming they are popular in particular market and they're in line with the international development, the technical is not the major issue. But in terms of development, MEPS labeling in the countries, I work a lot in Southeast Asia and the Pacific Island countries. The development process is still, you know, like Patrick said, it still takes time, but there are also other factors like market and also the political challenges that also, you know, hurdle the development. I'll give you an example. Some economies that the product types that are really popular in the local market, they are not popular in the international level. So hence, they do not have the good efficiency product available. One good example that would be like, you know, the Philippines, where the window types AC are still really popular. The market is shifting to the split unit. But until then, I think it's going to be difficult for the Philippines, you know, to, you know, impose some kind of very stringent MEP level, you know, until the market is already shifted to the split unit. So that will be one thing. For the political challenges, I mean, what I have seen, they're coming on both sides, from both supply side and also demand side. For the supply side, you can see that for economy that they have local manufacturers, the policymaker can expect, you know, resistance from the local industry. If the local industry cannot meet the MEP level that they are, you know, planning to enforce, in many countries, the policymaker, they often try to avoid confrontation with the industry opposition, which is not very understandable. In terms of the demand side, most of the appliances, small appliances that we are trying to promote MEPS and also energy level, they are used by the household. And also the annual usage is not really long. So we are talking about 2,000 or 3,000 hours per year. And with that, even you have very good efficiency, but if the cost is not, you know, in the good range, if the economic justification is going to be a very difficult and not very compelling argument for the residential usage. That also one thing that we found in Southeast Asia and also the Pacific Island countries. If we have some tools that can help all these economies that can overcome all this, and maybe perhaps some approaches that help them and guide them to reach an advanced MEPS level, that would be really helpful. That would be my reaction.
Thank you, Samai. And how about yourself, Dr. Liu? What any challenges that you or your team see as you're working to develop MEPS or update MEPS?
Yeah, thank you, Matt. Very glad to be here to share our Chinese story on MEPS. When we talk about MEPS, for China ourselves, we actually have a very special view of angle, because everybody knows during the past 40 years, we have a booming economy in China. So actually we experienced a lot. What we have experienced during the past 40 years might be what happened yesterday in many developed economies, but it is what is going on today in China. But for many developing countries and economies, it could be tomorrow for them. So what I want to share is maybe the history of China's MEPS, because we experience yesterday, today, and tomorrow. MEPS in China starts from the late 1980s. At that moment, we developed and released the first group of MEPS in China. And at that time, we basically grew up from zero on this topic. So what we have at that moment, what challenges we had at that moment, I would say the first point is data. Data is always the first thing, but for many developing economies, they don't have enough and good quality data. So first, we need to focus on collect and accumulate good data. So the second point, I think, is the capacity building. For many developing economies, when they started to develop their MEPS, maybe one of the biggest challenge is poor capacity building. So they need to do more capacity building. They need to educate their technical staff, all the stakeholders about basic knowledge of MEPS. They need to educate them from A to Z. The third point is research and development, R&D. That is the technical foundation for the MEPS. Through the R&D, we can work closely together with stakeholders, especially the industry partners. And finally, I think the international collaboration is very important for many developing economies, because at the first moment, they don't have enough technical expertise, they don't have enough knowledge. So usually the international organization could play an important role in collaboration at the first stage, at the very first beginning. So just as CLASP had already done, and actually right now you are still working on that. Because I didn't know when we developed our MEPS and energy labeling 30 years ago, CLASP play a very important role in providing international technical support. And thank you. And also, yeah, that is yesterday. And I think might be the challenges for many developing countries. Talk about what challenges we have for China ourselves today. We also have our own challenge, because as you show in your report, we can see actually the MEPS in China today for the room air conditioners and for the electric motors, we have already reached the very high level. I think that advanced the international levels, and the same levels as the European and the US and Japan, and all better than them. Today we already have 55 standards for on MEPS in China. It covers household appliances, commercial appliances and industrial equipment, many of them. So yes, right now we are, you know, reached an advanced international level, but as we often see, everything has two sides, a bright side and a dark side. Let me give you an example. It's just like we climb a mountain. So at the first, when you stand at, when you climb up to 200 meters high, it's very easy for you to climb up to another 200 meters higher. But right now for China, fortunately and unfortunately, we're standing at the point of maybe 8,000 meters higher. So it's very difficult for us to climb up maybe just 10 meters higher. It's very difficult. So as we know, so because right now we have already adopted the most advanced technology in the manufacturing, and we have already developed the most advanced method in developing MEPS. And right now we have the most famous manufacturers in China. And so everything I think we have already done. So 40 years ago, maybe we are just a beginner and we can learn many experiences from the others. But right now we actually become the forerunners. It's always very important when you find that yourself is a foreigner. So that's our challenges. But we also trying to find some solutions for these challenges. The first thing I think we need to integrate more cross-cutting technologies, advanced technologies into the MEPS. Let's say right now that more and more IT information technologies or the digital technologies have been applied, used in the appliances and equipment manufacturing. So let's say smart household appliances. So I have visited a lot of very good manufacturers in China. They are working on developing their own smart household appliances. I think this is very good when we're trying to, you know, develop a better MEPS. And second point, I think is system integration. I think another technical trend, especially for the industrial equipment, let's say the electric motors. As I know, in China and in the international partners, people right now are working on the electric motor system integration because it will improve when we apply the motors to the whole industrial process. It become a system energy efficiency improve. So we need to look up the whole thing. So it's also very important thing when we're trying to improve our MEPS for the industrial equipment. The third thing I think is optimize the operation. What I mean is that right now, when we talk about the energy efficiency of appliances, it's just the reaching appliances. It is the efficiency we tested under fixed conditions. It's different from the actual operation conditions when we, you know, when we use a room air conditioner in a regular customer family. It's different. So we need to look at how to test and how to indicate it and how to ensure the appliance equipment run at the highest efficiency it is supposed to be. I think that also a very important topic. That is what I want to share with you. Yeah, thank you.
That's great. No, thank you. You know, just to sum up for the audience, I think in terms of challenges, what we heard were people starting from scratch, right? So, you know, a tool that could help with that are model regulations. You know, international cooperation could help with that, providing examples. You know, on the other hand, something that's always lacking is data. Dr. Liu talked about the need for that data early on. Hopefully also international partners could help with some of that. But now moving in more into the present, what I heard was, you know, there are challenges around politics, product availability, cost effectiveness of efficiency, where if products aren't being used enough, you don't get the savings, which I guess, you know, Sumai mentioned in the context of household products, but I could see it also would apply, as Dr. Liu was saying, as products get more efficient, right? The prices will go up while the savings will decline. And so you always have to find new ways to get savings, which is, I guess, where the system integration is one option, or more realistic testing to really try to squeeze more savings or make sure you're getting savings under realistic conditions is how I would tie it all together. But of course, there you're introducing some complexity, right, Dr. Liu? You know, with system approaches, it gets harder. With more realistic test conditions, it gets harder. So, you know, I guess there we're starting to come back to what Patrick was saying about delays, right? Is all that stuff is going to take more time. So, well, good. I hope I caught most of the points here. You know, next question is a little easier. So can we flash that up here? Any particular product category that, you know, an economy that maybe you've worked on or that, you know, you've noticed that they should prioritize when advancing their MEPS? So, you know, Dr. Liu, maybe we'll start with you here, since you just touched on industrial products and systems as being a ready opportunity. Anything else, you know, either within China or outside China that you would recommend?
I think basically it depends on the economy development in your countries or in your economies. Back to the late 1980s, when we developed or released the first group of MAPS standards in China, it actually includes air conditioners, washing machine, and refrigerators. Because first, when you're trying to develop and implement it, MAPS, you need to identify the appliances or equipment which has been most widely used in your economies. Which means there's a great potential for you to improve your energy efficiency because they are widely used. That means you can, you know, improve the efficiency greatly in a short time through the MAPS. Based on Chinese experiences, in the household appliances category, usually air conditioners, room air conditioners is our first choices because it's the biggest energy consuming appliances. And in the industrial sectors, I prefer to choose the electric motors. It is widely used in the industrial sectors, but you know, it depends. Like I just mentioned, depends on the economy situation in your economies, in your, especially for the household appliances. The first point is regular family in your, they should be affordable for that household appliances, since which could be widely used. If they cannot affordable for room air conditioners, it's gonna be not that good to choose that one.
Yeah, should we turn over to Patrick? Feel free to repeat the list of model regulations, as I imagine those are the products that you think are the best choice for the most economies. So love to hear that list again. But also, are there any products that aren't on that list, you know, that maybe are too specific or too niche, but important in some contexts? And so something to consider even when there is no model regulation.
Yeah, no, it's a good question. So as far as particular products, before just getting to that, to highlight that it's not a one-off effort, that MEPS, and because the technology is advancing, that MEPS also need to advance with that. Just because the country does have a policy in place, that policy could be very outdated. With the model regulations and with the reports, we see there's a need for many countries to update across various products. Following up on one point that Dr. Liu mentioned is that the opportunity to work on more than one product. Just going through the policy process, so potentially working on multiple products at the same time is what some countries do, but not all. But I would encourage to consider that within that, given that you're spending the time and resources to consider working on more than one product at a time, because then you get the savings earlier than going one by one. And then as far as particular opportunities, I think it's dependent on the economy. And going back to the previous question on tools, there's different tools available to show the potential growth of some of the key products that we presented. And that includes the U4E country saving assessments and also the CLASP MEPS tool. So within those, both those and others, you're able to see at the country level for a particular country, the savings opportunity. So that can be an initial tool to help prioritize what products to work on. But on the particular product, we're working in a number of countries on cooling. Cooling is typically the largest savings opportunity through room air conditioners. And that also offers greenhouse gas savings from refrigerants as well. We're working in the model regulations includes both those points as well. So efficiency and refrigerants within that. So we're working in countries with ASEAN member states, as Samai mentioned, but also in East and Southern Africa in 21 countries. So I think that's a large opportunity. Briefly, I mentioned as well on the lighting side, it's one that many countries started with. Some developed countries have implemented MEPS for lighting products. The case is also attractive because the product turnover is quicker. So with there with larger savings in terms of financial savings and greenhouse gas savings in the next 5-10 years with the products.
And also fast technology improvement too, right? In lighting.
Yeah, exactly. LEDs save a lot more compared to an incandescent or even a halogen lamp. So I think that's one product that was a focus in the past, but I think still there's a lot of opportunities for work on lighting as well. So, thanks.
Great. Thank you, Patrick. How about yourself, Samai? Briefly, in your bio, you mentioned working across a whole number of countries in several continents. You know, any other products from that experience that stand out, or anything that you want to second that the other panelists have already flagged?
Okay. Yeah, first, I mean, all the product listed in your study is actually that's the priorities that should be considered by all the countries, you know. For the country which is hot and humid, they probably don't think about the space heater and, you know, water heater. But the freezers is very popular among the small island development state. So especially chest freezer, even the upright freezer. I think maybe you should kind of, you know, include that in your next version or edition of the study or the benchmarking. And what I also have seen is that when the country, the economy developed, the household income, you know, is getting, you know, more and more earning, the clothes washer and dryer also have a good penetration. And that, I think you probably need to include those. For me, I mean, I would like the freezer, clothes washer and dryer should be the three others, you know, product that should be included in the benchmarking exercises. And also maybe for the country, I need to look at it and see if it will be a good time, you know, for you to include all this product in your MEPS labeling.
That's great, thank you. And I see, I think one question from the audience already. For a small economy which currently does not have MEPS, is it realistic for them to reach the target level, you know, the level in the U4E regulations, or perhaps, I guess we could talk about the heating ones as well, but let's start with the U4E regulations. Would it be realistic for them to reach those levels soon? Let's say, you know, by the end of the decade or within, you know, a few years? What advice would you have in this scenario? And maybe let's start with Patrick on this one. I imagine as you talk about these regulations with a variety of countries, what kind of response are you getting?
Well, I think in some ways with a smaller economy that's not a manufacturing country of the product, it offers opportunity to advance in a more quick manner. Since there is no local industry, that is a stakeholder group that needs to be addressed. Governments, of course, isn't going to want to eliminate a local manufacturer, and it's important to work with those local manufacturers for upgrade. But yeah, for a small country without it, I think it offers an opportunity to progress quickly, going through the normal policy process and consultations, and then still giving time for importers of those products notification, typically 1 year. So I think it's certainly reasonable to expect that the model regulations can be implemented in countries. The other points that I would like to highlight is those model regulations. Some are the cooling ones, for example, are from 2019. So that's already almost four years ago. We developed at the end of 2019. So I think that's also something to consider. As I mentioned earlier, the technology is advancing. There's large economies such as China that have MEPS at these levels for their economy, that it offers opportunity for imports inter-country that would normally be cost effective for the product. But of course, there needs to be some assessment to back that up. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, how about you, Sumai? What are you seeing in terms of the achievability of these, the targets, which are based mainly on the model regulations?
So I think within this decade, I think it's doable, provided that the popular model in each particular market, in that particular market, is something that they can enjoy the economy of scale from the supply side. Because then we can, negate the price equation from our implementation model. I think that what I see in the, it may not be applicable to all types and category of products, but in certain category, for example, the split type, AC with the cooling capacity below, perhaps 3 kilowatt or maybe 4.5 kilowatt. That I think that really, looking promising, in some other product, I think we need to do some sort of assessment and to be able to back the timeline that we are looking at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just as a reminder, right, several of the economies we looked at and many others, 15 in all, have committed to double the efficiency of the average, typical appliance in our for non-heating categories by the end of the decade. So it will be important to get that done.
And Matt, I would like to add in this, I think we should not treat MEPS as standalone policy measures.
Okay.
We should link MEPS with the higher climate change agenda. Example, like in the link MEPS with the NDC and make it clear. And we already started, I think before COVID, I think the Climate Works Foundation already support doing this kind of work, but then with the COVID and things got delayed. But I think we should continue and reinforce that MEP should be a part of a larger climate change agenda. And if we can link the MEPs with the Article 6, so under the Paris Agreement, that the smaller economy may be able to enjoy, voluntary program, and also climate the transaction between the larger economy and smaller economy.
Sorry, just to clarify, Article 6, is it assistance? Is it financial assistance? Is that?
Yeah, there is a room for that. There is a room for voluntary support from the rich economy to the poor economy. Yeah. Thanks.
Great. Matt. Great. No, thank you. Dr. Liu, maybe I'll ask a slightly different question. Patrick talked about the U4E regulations already being, it's been several years, at least for the AC one, which of course is what China's MEPs are, and they are still world leading, and they were very ambitious when they were first adopted. What's next? What do you see? Do you think there will be a next revision to that MEPs anytime soon, or are you looking at the remainder of the 55 standards to revise? How do you see the balance between kind of pushing on some of these categories where there are the most savings but it may be difficult versus the categories that are smaller savings, but you don't want them to get out of a date. How do you see that balance?
You mean the possible revision to our AC MEPS in China?
Yeah, you know, or for other economies, you know, where do you see the importance of to keep pushing for some of these product categories that are the bigger consumers, like ACs, versus ones that you know, maybe are smaller, but the work could go a little faster or easier because, you know, the MEPS isn't as ambitious. So, you know, to give your analogy of the mountain, you know, do you keep climbing up a bunch of 2,000 meter mountains, or do you really struggle on that 8,000 meter mountain?
Actually, I think that it's just like I just mentioned earlier. So it depends on what stage the economy is on. So, I want to repeat it that if right now you are just decided to start it from zero, develop the map in your country. So it is very important for you to identify the right product to develop maps, because it is so important, because before that people know nothing or know very few about maps, and they have many worries, and maybe somebody fear about, because usually when people know nothing about one thing, the first reaction is worry, is fear, correct?
That's fair.
So first, we need to start from a thing that is relatively easier to achieve success. We need to give people more confidence about this thing. That's very important thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why for many developing countries, when they develop their first maps, usually they choose a small appliances like lighting product, or maybe rice cooker, something like this. So because it's relatively easier. So a second thing, I think for many developing economies, they need to try to involve stakeholders as many as possible into the team to develop the maps. They need to, you know, develop and implementation maps is teamwork. So we need to involve them together. So when people get to know, yes, I can achieve something from the maps, I can benefit from the maps, they will be, you know, become positive for this thing. That's very important thing. Right now, they have confidence in maps. And then we can move to the second stage. We can choose some, you know, widely used and important appliances like the, you know, air conditioners, like the fridge. So, and then we can move to the second stage. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about China, you know, like I just mentioned, right now, we are becoming foreigners. We know nothing before ahead of us, because as I just mentioned, right now we are standing at 8,000 meters. There's no people climb up, you know, higher. So we need to, you know, I think to do more research and analysis. We need to do more things for the preparatory work for the potential revision of maps, because, you know, there's a little room or not that room for us to improve energy efficiency, as we have already achieved during the past 30 years. So yes, but anyway, I think China could play more and more important roles in international collaboration and experience in sharing a map.
Mm-hmm.
We would like to share our experiences, good or bad, with all the partners and with all the economies. And so it's also a teamwork.
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
No, that's great. And thank you for that. And it sounds like, it sounds like even when you're starting, you know, getting some kind of MEPS out there to reassure people, you know, of course, the trick then is to be able to revise it, right? Which I know can be a challenge. You know, sometimes people think it's one and done, but as Patrick mentioned, needs to be revised. But one thing that I think helps with that revision, and this ties into a question we just received, is the market surveillance program, right? Once you establish a MEPS, oftentimes, you know, you have data reporting, you have surveillance or compliance efforts that allow you to gather data for the next revision, right? A lot more confidently. And so, you know, that's one function or one role of a market surveillance program, is that it helps countries revise their MEPS, keep track of the product, you know, the MEPS on the market. But of course, it's not their primary role, right? The primary role is for the compliance. So the question is, let's talk about compliance, you know, our market surveillance programs, because they're important to ensuring that the MEPS is being complied with. Any thoughts on that? Any tips that you could like offer, that you could offer to economies setting up such programs for the first time? Maybe we'll start with Somai this time.
Well, for the country that they started program for the first time, I think the main effort should be on the registration and make sure that when the product making an entry to the market, you will put a very stringent way to control the product that enter into the market. And then market surveillance probably maybe in the second priorities, you know, after you implement it, and then you see the whether you will be able to screen the product effectively. And then, yeah, you can think about the cost-effective way of to do market surveillance. Mm-hmm. That, I think that would be my recommendation for the country that they just started. I think looking at the registration, how you're going to screen the product that enter to the market, that will be, you make it good, so you don't have to worry about the market surveillance later on. But having said that, market surveillance is still very important, as you said, Matt, because you still need the data to move into the next step. So that help you. But in terms of the effectiveness of the MEPS program itself, I would recommend starting at the beginning, you know, at the beginning of the process. Thank you.
Thank you, Somai. I don't think I distinguished between the two sides well enough in my statement, right? So the registration is at the beginning, right? It's a way for the manufacturer to kind of demonstrate or claims. Oftentimes it's just a self reporting, right? That they comply with the MEPS. Versus the market surveillance is later on following up to see if that initial claim was right. Is that correct? I think I didn't draw enough of a distinction between them. So yeah, maybe Patrick, if we could turn to you. You know, you in your bio, you talked about setting up these registration systems, helping developing the tools. Is there a kind of ready to go registration database that economy? I know you know, it boggles my mind that every time a country wants to set this up, it's a whole big software development effort, right? Every country needs to go through this process. You know, why isn't there a Google product registration database that you can just use and download? Or are you working on such a thing that will make it easy for countries to do this?
Yeah. So we have worked together with IIC actually on a product registration system software. And just to step back for describing that a bit, because the reason why we worked on this is really in parallel to the model regulations. If we just have MEPS, they need to be enforced, and we need to ensure that the products in the market are compliant with the MEPS. And a product registration system is a very important starting point for a country that's just starting in this process, in that it helps to understand what products are in the market, the type of products, the efficiency of the products, And that can help in setting MEPS levels and updating MEPS levels over time. So that's very helpful. And then also, as I mentioned, to ensure that the products are compliant. And that can help in doing checks in stores and at customs as well. So because of that, we developed the software because, again, as you mentioned, it takes considerable resources for development of that software. And we saw multiple countries going through that. So it is a tool that is available. So if there's interest from anybody, please contact us. And we'd be happy to discuss further on that. Thanks, Matt.
Great, thank you. So that I think that covers registrations really well. How about market surveillance itself? You know, any thoughts there? And I'll open up to any of the panelists that want to add anything about making market surveillance efforts. Gosh, I don't know, cost effective, just effective in general, most useful, whatever thoughts you have.
Oh, let me start, Matt. Well, I think there are several guidelines, and I know CLASP also produce, you know, guideline on the market surveillance. And in that, I think they also, you know, recommend the cost effective way in doing market surveillance. For country, which is they do not have the local testing facility. And when you need to do some sort of market surveillance program for the product that would need to really do extensive testing, I think that that would be expensive, okay? So as a policymaker, when they develop MEPS and labeling, I think they probably maybe need to think this in advance. And maybe the market surveillance program for the smaller economy maybe focus on something simple. Like for example, just go to the store and check whether the product that they carry that meet all the requirements. When it comes to really checking the energy performance of the product, maybe you need to think, you know, in more detail, how you're gonna do that. Maybe trying to collaborate with other countries with the same product model that could help, you know, without, you know, investing a lot in the market surveillance program. In doing all this, there are various ways in do product sampling. I mean, I would not touch upon on that aspect because there'll be a lot of, you know, detail into that. But what I'm trying to say is, if you don't have local in-country resources, maybe you need to think of a simple way to do market surveillance and also benefit your MEPS and labeling.
Mm-hmm. No, thank you for that. And yeah, it's a topic that you can go quite deep on, right? Yeah, you mentioned sampling. You know, I know within CLASP, we usually recommend risk-based, you know, market surveillance where you don't test random products, but you look at ones that, you know, based on your registration database, maybe are really close to the line or what you know to be popular products, right? Because if that product fails, then it affects the greatest number of people, right? Versus some niche products. So, our questioner is really asking for, I think, these resources. And so, you know, I think we can definitely point them to some CLASP resources on we call it compliance, right? And so that would be one place to search. But you know, if folks have any other examples or resources relating market surveillance, please feel free to speak up.
Hi, Matt. May I add something
please.
To this mm-hmm. topic? Yeah. So in China, actually, we have a whole system for the market surveillance. Each year, the government will organize the market inspection on the national level and also on the provincial levels. That also inspection, market inspection will be organized. And there is some new trend I want to share with you. The first, also, you know, each year, we will organize a round robin test in among the test laboratories. And as I just mentioned, right now we're trying to integrate it more advanced technology into the market surveillance things as the MEPS. and talking about digital technologies. Let's say right now we are working on to develop a digital network among the important test laboratories, which could facilitate the data collection and sharing with the test lab. And also another new thing that I think you already indicated in your report is a QR code in the antigen labeling system called several years ago, we started to include the QR code in our antigen label. And the experiences we got from the past year that it's a very good tool for us to do the market surveillance. It makes the whole thing easier and clear for all the stakeholders. And no, for the market inspectors, they just need to scan the code. For the regular consumers, they just need to scan the code. And then the important information they wanted to know will pop up. And also, you know, another thing is the database behind the QR code. It's a huge database, and also it's a growing database. We can include the more and more new information into the QR code. So it will make the whole thing easier and easier. So it's not very difficult. I think for many of the economies, they could do the things. I think the important thing is a huge database behind the QR code. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's what I want to share with you. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Dr. Liu. I think you know, I've heard of QR codes as a good resource for consumers, shoppers, but it makes sense that it would be even better for market surveillance or data entry. You know, getting the model number from behind the product while it's on the shelf is its own challenge here. Well, we're almost near the end of our time. So if there is any more questions from the audience, this is your last chance. Please feel free to type it into either the chat or the Q&A, accessible through buttons probably at the bottom of your screen. Otherwise, if you don't mind, Shireen, sharing your screen again, we'll just go over a couple more tools as well as where to find some of the research while we wait for any last questions. So as I mentioned again, the URL or the website to type into is clasp.ngo/tools. And in addition to World's Best MEPS, you'll find the MEPSI tool, which I think Patrick mentioned, helps with prioritizing and analyzing different policy scenarios. We have the CPRC, or CLASP Policy Resource Center, which lists over 1,500 policies in 130 economies around the world. You can filter them by economy, by product type, and very exciting new feature, you can now easily map them so that you can quickly tell where in the world different policies apply. We also try to keep these updated with links to the policies so that if you want to get more detail, you can go straight to the source and learn about that. So we hope these tools are useful to you as you, our audience, as you work to develop these policies, revise them to make them more ambitious, and of course, you know, make sure that people are complying with them so that they are having the impact that they can have. With that, I'd like to wrap up and thanks you to our panel. Thank you so much for spending the morning or the evening with us here. We hope this was a good experience. I certainly learned a lot and I'm really grateful for your time and your contributions. And thank you so much to our audience. We hope that you enjoyed this and are newly energized to keep pushing for world's best MEPS around the world. Thank you, everybody.